MCCBR.
Morning. Morning.
Happy Mother's Day to all the moms. We're glad you're here to worship with us this morning, and we would like you to please rise as you're able and join us in our opening songs.
One day every knee will bow.
stand, would you pray and praise with me this morning? God, we thank you for this time we have in your house. We came here to worship you. We came here to worship you not just individually, even though we're going to do that, because it really comes from each of our hearts. But it is so wonderful when we can come together as a community of faith and worship you in concert.
Amen.
And God, we just thank you for all that you've done for us, all that you are to us.
Yes,
we praise you because we are in your presence right now, and you are in us. We ask now that you will bless continuously through this service. God, that you will continue to minister to the needs of your children. Whatever we came in need of today, whatever we stand in need of right now, we ask that those needs be met before we leave this place today, so that each one of us are changed for the better before we leave here today. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Before you're seated, would you turn to a couple of people and say, Happy Mother's Day, you look good.
Happy Mother's Day, you look good.
Happy Mother's Day, you look happy.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Acts chapter 17, verses 22 through 30. So the Apostle Paul took his stand in the open space at the Areopagus and laid it out for everyone. It is plain to see that you Athenians take your religion seriously. When I arrived here the other day, I was fascinated with all the shrines I came across. And then I found one inscribed to the God nobody knows. I'm here to introduce you to this God so that you can worship intelligently, know who you're dealing with. The God who made the world and everything in it, this master of sky and land, does not live in custom-made shrines or need the human race to run errands as if God couldn't take care of God's self. God makes the creatures. The creatures don't make God. Starting from scratch, God made the entire human race and made the earth hospitable, with plenty of time and space for living so we could seek after God and not just grope around in the dark, but actually find God. God doesn't play hide and seek with us. God's not remote, God's near. We live and move in God, can't get away from God. One of your poets said it well, we're the God created. Well, if we are the God created, it doesn't make a lot of sense to think we could hire a sculptor to chisel a God out of stone for us, does it? God overlooks it as long as you don't know any better, but that time is past. The unknown is now known, and God's calling for a radical life change. Hear what the Spirit says today.
Thanks be to God.
Today, before I preach, you know, our denomination, I need to tell you this, especially you new folks, Metropolitan Community Church has been around since 1968. And it was built on a three-prong mission. Now, those of you that have been around a while, you already know this, so it's old news to you. You can probably tell it just as well as I can. But the denomination is built on three things. A message of relationship with God, or what, you know, fundamentalists call salvation. A sense of community. We're Metropolitan Community Church. So that we have brothers and sisters and we build a support system around us. But the third part is social action. Now, what's right in front of us obviously is GLBT issues for our denomination in particular, but not just those issues, for any kind of social justice, because we believe that that's what our denomination is called to do according to the scriptures, that every person is called to do. Well, you know that I am, as I said a while ago, from North Carolina, and last week, during the week, you know that Amendment 1 came up in North Carolina, and I really, being from afar off, I really did think it had a good chance of passing so that they would not. Now, just so you know, gay marriage is already illegal in North Carolina, just like it is here. But they wanted to, someone wanted to change the Constitution because they want to help preserve the white race. You'll have to figure out the logic. I can't. And this was an elected officer. But anyway, they wanted to make it even more difficult. And I went to bed Tuesday night after hearing the results that it actually had passed and that they have now put that in the Constitution. And I went to bed really sad. And you know, I'm all about posting how I feel on Facebook, but I went to bed without posting anything because I thought if I better not say anything. Because I was angry, but I was hurt. And I thought, before I say anything to anybody, I need to just rest. And I need to, you know, just let this, you know, go for tonight, and I'll worry about it tomorrow. It means that we just have to fight harder. And then the next day, I turn on the TV, and this is what I saw.
Welcome back to News. An historic day for the struggle for gay rights in America. President Obama, seconds ago, signaling that he is in favor of gay marriage. He did so in an interview with Robin Roberts on ABC. Here's what he had to say.
I have to tell you, as I said, I've been going through an evolution on this issue. I've always been adamant that gay and lesbian Americans should be treated fairly and equally. And that's why, in addition to everything we've done in this administration, rolling back Don't Ask, Don't Tell, so that outstanding Americans can serve our country, whether it's no longer defending the Defense Against Marriage Act, which tried to federalize what has historically been state law, I've stood on the side of broader equality for the LGBT community. And I had hesitated on gay marriage, in part because I thought civil unions would be sufficient, that was something that would give people hospital visitation rights and other elements that we take for granted. I was sensitive to the fact that for a lot of people, you know, the word marriage was something that evokes very powerful traditions, religious beliefs, and so forth. But I have to tell you that over the course of several years, as I talk to friends and family and neighbors, when I think about members of my own staff who are in incredibly committed monogamous relationships, same-sex relationships, who are raising kids together, when I think about those soldiers or airmen or Marines or sailors who are out there fighting on my behalf and yet feel constrained, even now that Don't Ask, Don't Tell is gone, because they're not able to commit themselves in a marriage. At a certain point, I've just concluded that for me personally, it is important for me to go ahead and affirm that I think same-sex couples should be able to get married.
So there you go, what many gay people have wanted the President of the United States to say for many years now. He is in favor of gay marriage, no ifs, ands, or buts. We'll see what he does now to make sure that it becomes law in this country. It will, of course, be a big factor now in the upcoming presidential election. You're watching NewsHour.
Y'all awfully quiet. Now, I said on Wednesday, here's what we should have done, because I don't care if you're Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, unaffiliated. I don't care if you're a U.S. citizen or not. I don't care who you are. I don't care about the politics. I don't care about the religion. Hello. Amen. What I do know is this. This part I know is that one of the, if not the most powerful voice in the world today, just gave me a pat on the back and said, you're just as equal as I am, whether the law says you are or not. And I want to tell you something else. This was the moment for all GLBT people and their allies to be dancing together in the streets.
Amen.
We should have been rejoicing, rejoicing, rejoicing. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all still kind of quiet about it.
Amen.
Maybe it just hasn't hit you yet what he did. Now, I know it didn't change the laws, but it will. Yes, it will. It will change down the road. It may be a little more fighting, a little more. And you know, I saw people immediately get on Facebook and start condemning the president, some religious folk, and even a few gay folks. And I'm like, will y'all just lay your swords down for 1 minute and let us relish in this moment just for a minute, just for a day. Let us have the word of our president.
Amen.
And not because I'm trying to get you to vote for him, although it wouldn't hurt my feelings if you did. I'm just saying
Amen.
That it's not about promoting one and not one person or one party or any of that. It's about civil liberties.
Yes.
It's about rights and benefits
Amen.
For all people.
Amen.
And that is an important issue for our denomination and for our country. It is a time, and I did this not long ago. This, by the way, is not your sermon, so I'm going to get back to the sermon in a minute. This is pre-sermon, okay? But I just need to tell you something that a few weeks ago I told you how I feel about marriage and that we as GLBT people, why in the world do we want to fight for an institution that over half of it has failed. And I will tell you again why. Because, and I'm going to tell you something else. I believe part of the reason that we don't have more rights as GLBT people and we have this kind of voting like we did in North Carolina already in 30 states, I believe part of the reason is that we as GLBT people cannot get on the same page and articulate exactly what we want. You see, I have gay friends that say there's no need to fight for marriage. Over 50% of them fail, so what's the point? I have other gay friends that say, well, I don't want marriage. I want a civil union. We can have our rights if we just get a civil union. You know, separate but equal. Some of you older folks know what that means. And some of you that have studied civil rights know what that means. And probably most people that in here that are black skinned know what that means. Because you grew up knowing what that meant. Hello?
Yes.
I know I'm older than a lot of you, but I'm telling you, I remember separate but equal.
Yep.
I remember affirmative action.
Yep.
And I remember it was in the churches that these kinds of things played out. And if you'll look around, you will see that we are a mixed group in here today. But I want you to go to most of the other churches in the area and see just how mixed they are. Because they don't want to be mixed. I'm not talking about, well, you know what I'm talking about. I better stop there or I will go on. That will be my sermon. And it's Mother's Day. I got to talk about mothers in a minute. But I... Thank you. But I will tell you this. Here's the reason we must fight for marriage. There are probably 1,500 or more laws on the local, on the state, and on the federal level that give special rights. And you need to articulate this. You need to say that with me. Say special rights. Because, you know, we hear that coming this way. The pushback says, y'all just want special rights. No, we want your rights. You have special rights if you are a legally married person in America today. There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, over 1,000 laws that are special rights just for married persons in this country.
Yes.
That's why, in fact, if you don't want to fight for your, you know, maybe the word marriage gets on under your skin. It makes me crawl a little bit too. I just want to tell you something. Even though that's not what I would wish for us, I wish it were all civil unions. We could do away with the word marriage for straight and gay people. It would be fine with me. Because we can have a legal document that's a contract, or we can have a holy union at our churches. Either way, it all works. And there are some confounded, convoluted kind of relations relationships among the straight folks these days too, just so you know.
Yeah, that's right.
But I just want to say that we have to fight for marriage. Otherwise, people say, well, if we just get civil unions, we'll have the same thing. No, we won't. Here's the reason. You have to start at the beginning over each one of those individual laws to get it changed so that it includes, you know, people say, well, we'll get a civil union, and that'll just mean that all the rights that married people get, we'll get. No, it won't. That's not the way the legal system works. So if we want all of the rights of married people, we have to fight for marriage. And if you need some help, if you need some tutoring articulating that, please come see me. I will help you with that. Amen.
Amen.
I could not let today go by without thanking our president, and I don't care whether you're Republican or Democrat or whatever. I don't care if you don't even consider yourself political. I don't care if you're a person of faith or not a person of faith. I'm telling you that when someone is powerful, by virtue of his office, someone that powerful says that publicly, things start to change. A lot of what we have been fighting for so long is about to open up. And I want to know, are you ready to walk in freedom? I was talking to someone last week about the North Carolina Amendment 1. I said, you know what? I'm 53 years old, and I still keep wondering, will I live long enough to not know what it's like? Could I live one day having equal rights with other Americans? I just don't know. I really don't know if I'll ever live that long to see total equal rights and liberty and justice for all, not just some, not just for a few, not just for straight people or married people or white Anglo-Saxon Protestants or Catholics. They're Protestants. All right, your pre-sermon is done. Go out and fight for your rights. I'm going to tell you, these guys walking across the country have kind of fired me up. If they can walk across America and they've been at it over a year, what am I doing or not doing? Boy, do I hold my head in shame sometimes. So today's Mother's Day. Let's get to the sermon. You heard this reading where the Apostle Paul is walking by and there's this thing. And he asked, what is this? And they say, well, this is the unknown God. This is where we worship the unknown God. Can you imagine worshiping something you didn't know the name of it? I remember a missionary coming to our church in my hometown from South, and he came up from South America. And I remember him talking about going down into the jungles. And yes, there are jungles down in South America. You get down there, tropical rainforest, a lot of people get down there and can't come back. It's tough down there, and there's a lot of disease down in there, but there are some people that have never seen real civilization. Little packs of people, little tribes of people. John Grisham's book, The Testament, if you haven't read that, please read it. It will bless you, bless you, bless you. But it describes, even though it's a book of fiction, it's built on a true story, and you can hear a lot more in detail about that. Or if you see the movie The Mission, it will help you with that as well. Good one for you, Miss Becky, if you're going into ministry. The Mission. It's an old movie, but it's very, very powerful.
Great music, too.
Yeah. In the reading, we find that Paul says, well, who is this God? Oh, I was on the missionary. I'm sorry. I lost my train when you got me off on the music. It's all right. My head went somewhere else. The missionary came and was talking about how they had traveled deep into the jungles and they ran across this small tribe of Indian people in South America. And they didn't have the language. They didn't have Jesus. They had never seen or heard of a Bible. They didn't know what that was. They had no holy books of any kind. But as the missionaries stayed with them and got to know them, they saw this one object up there. And they noticed the people occasionally going over to that object. And he said, what is that? And he said, that is represents our Creator. We don't know who that is. We don't know how we got here. We don't know. But there's got to be more than what we see. It was God. And it was a symbol or an image for God. They weren't trying to be an idol worshippers. They just didn't have any other language for it. So they just named it. But as that out there kind of thing. And the missionaries gave them words for that, much like the Apostle Paul did in this reading. He said, well, let me just fill you in on who the unknown God is so that God is not unknown to you anymore. You see, we're about having a relationship with God, that word salvation that many of us grew up with. We're about relationship with God. And when I was preparing for Mother's Day service and thinking of what I was going to preach about and asking God for direction, I just kept hearing the word, Mother God, Mother God, Mother God, Mother God. And I said, okay, then let's do some research on Mother God. I ran across a blog by Carl Grigg. Here's what he has to say. Sandy Eisenberg Sasso has written a wonderful children's book called In God's Name, that affirms the need to call God by many names, such as Source of Life, Creator of Light, Shepherd, Maker of Peace, My Rock, Healer, Redeemer, Ancient One, Comforter, Mother, Father, Friend. We call God by many names because we recognize the limits of our human language and that no one name for God can capture the fullness of God. Sasso also reassures us that at the end of her story, that all of the individual voices ultimately merge together to call God one. The composer Brian Wren has a similarly themed hymn called Bring Many Names. The lyrics speak of strong Mother God working night and day, planning all the wonders of creation. Warm Father God, hugging every child, feeling all the strains of human living. Old aching God, wiser than despair. Young, growing God, eager, on the move, crying out for justice. And finally, in the last verse, great living God, never fully known. Joyful darkness far beyond our seeing, closer yet than breathing. So in our worship, we bring many names for God. But as Sasso's story reminds us, we also call God one. In dialogue with our Jewish and Muslim sisters and brothers, we can affirm our belief in monotheism that God is one. Now, we sing in MCC all over the world, MCC's this song called Bring Many Names that he was quoting from. And we've sung it here several times. In fact, we were thinking of singing it here today, and it will be played during the communion service. So you can sing along with it, but I'd like for him to put the words up so we can just look at them for a minute. And think of the many names of God as you know God. Bring many names, beautiful and good. Celebrate in parable and story. Holiness in glory, living, loving God. Hail and Hosanna, bring many names. Strong Mother God, it is Mother's Day, you know. Working night and day, planning all the wonders of creation, setting each equation, genius at play. Hail and Hosanna, strong Mother God. Warm Father God, hugging every child, feeling all the strains of human living, caring and forgiving till we're reconciled. Hail and Hosanna, warm Father God. Old, aching God, gray with endless care, calmly piercing evil's new disguises, glad of good surprises, wiser than despair, hail and Hosanna, old, aching God. Young, growing God, eager on the move, saying no to falsehood and unkindness, crying out for justice, giving all you have, hail and Hosanna, young, growing God, great, living God, never fully known, joyful darkness far beyond our seeing, closer yet than breathing, everlasting home, hail and Hosanna, great, living God. I love all of the mixture in there. God is all that and more. God is both and neither. God is all. Powerful song, lots of names, lots of images of God. But you know, we're bombarded constantly with Father-only language. If you pick up most any Bible and start reading, it's Father this, Father that. Most of the video clips that we pull off of YouTube or we get from our license and with some of the other music companies, almost all of them are very masculine-oriented God. In fact, the reading of the scripture most of the time is inclusified for you because I take the time to do it. I had to take out he and his about 20 times out of the scripture that Rhonda read today and put God or you or your. And instead of himself, God's self. Why? Because we go to the masculine language, masculine, masculine, masculine. Is there anything wrong with having a masculine God? No, there's nothing wrong with that. However, a lot of us cannot relate to a masculine God, at least not every minute of every day. Sometimes I need the loving arms of my mama, just so you know. One of the greatest memories, my mom's been dead for 43 years. She died in a car accident when I was 10 years old, and one of the last memories I have of her is her holding me, even, yes, at 10 years old, holding me in her arms and letting me lay my head on her shoulder. And her having her arms around me, I felt so safe. And I remember how soft she was. And I remember the sweet fragrance of her smell, her perfume. That's a wonderful image, and sometimes I need that instead of a father. Sometimes I need all sorts of other things. In the last couple of weeks, I've suffered some loss with family and friends, and I just want to say to you, I've needed a comforter. I needed somebody to comfort me, and thank God for you spirit-filled folks that have just comforted and comforted and comforted me and been there for me. I appreciate it. We keep God in a small box when we only allow God to be he. Well, there are many images in the scriptures. I can find the piece of paper that I just had. You see, I preach all of these Bibles and I hold on to stuff. Here we go. Those of you Bible scholars know these books of the Bible probably. In Jeremiah and Job, they talk about God's creative womb. What? God has a womb? How many of us males have one? Don't answer. Deuteronomy talks about the God who gave you birth. Isaiah says, you have been born by me from your birth, carried from the womb. One of the names of God that we hear is El Shaddai. Did you know that even though they play it down in our masculine-oriented scriptures, that El Shaddai deals with fertility 5 out of the 6 times that Genesis references. Hosea calls, God calls Israel her child. Psalm says, but I have calmed and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. In Luke, God is a woman sweeping her house looking to find a lost coin. In Deuteronomy again, God is a caring mother eagle. In Hosea, God is a mother bear protecting her cubs. And even in Luke, Jesus, walking around disguised as a man, says his mother, he is a mother hen gathering her brood under her wing. That's pretty powerful imagery, especially for those of us who have seen a mother hen and her biddies. So some of the images we have of God are not just masculine. In fact, a lot of the scriptures are the feminine side of God. God has many names in our faith. And I want to tell you, it made me a little uncomfortable. Some years ago, I went out west on a visit and went to our home church, our mother church, MCC Los Angeles. And they would get up, and every time they'd finish a prayer, they'd, instead of saying like we do here in the South, in the name of Jesus, and we Pentecostals, in the name of Jesus, they would say, in the many names of God. And I got uncomfortable. I'll tell you why I got uncomfortable, because I didn't know if they meant all of those Christian names or if they were looking outside. Because yes, God can be my Prince of Peace and my Counselor and my Comforter. God can be my Bread of Life and my Cup of Joy. God can be my Mother Eagle or my Mother Hen. But I wasn't so sure if we looked outside of that, what we might find. And I was worried about that at the time. It took me a little while to rub up against that sandpaper, that theological sandpaper, until God got me smoothed out, and now it doesn't bother me at all. If you call God Black Elk because you're a Native American, I'm okay with that. If you call God Muhammad, I'm okay with that. If you call God something else that's out of my comfort zone or my original comfort zone, I'm okay with that. You know why? Because of that book, God is one. God is all of our creator. We can put names on, but as I told you a while ago, the missionaries showed people they didn't even have names. The Apostle Paul in our reading today, they had an unknown God. They had an unknown. They didn't know the name of God. And when you name something, it gives it power. I do understand that. But more than that is when you have a relationship with your Creator. When you have a relationship with that has created you, that's more powerful. And you can name that anything you want. And just so you know, it doesn't have to be the same name today that it is tomorrow or that it was yesterday. It can be comforter. It can be source of strength. It can be friend. It can be Father God. It can also be Mother God or sister or brother. What's really important is that one-on-one, that relationship that you have so that you can call each other pet names all day long. Because God may have pet names for you too. Because that's how you roll. You know, they say that the strongest bond on earth is between, and some of you are shaking your heads, you already know what I'm going to say, is between a mother and her child. And I just want to say, that's all right. Happy Mother's Day to our Mother God. Comes time for us to receive our offering. You know that we give around here. We're a giving bunch. We don't just give our money. We give our time and our talents. And I just want you to know that I'm delighted when I see you stepping up, not just with finances, but with all the other things. But as we take our offering, please remember that part of our offering stays here in our local church. Part of it goes out into the community here in Baton Rouge, and part of it goes to our denomination and goes all around the world. That's our, as Danny says, our MCCBR worldwide. I love it. Would you pray with me? God, we ask you to bless us now as we give back a portion of what you have given to us. We thank you because you've made us able to be able to give financially and support this church, this community, and also others around the world. We ask you to just pour it back into us and help us to manage well and be good stewards of what you've given us. In Christ's name and in the many names that we know you. Amen. Amen. My sisters and brothers, it comes time for us to offer ourselves once again and come to the table of God and feast yet again. You see, we are all welcome at God's table. You know why? Because over 2,000 years ago, Jesus was having a meal with his disciples. And I know we all look back at the 12 disciples, but we don't know that it was just them. It was probably lots of other folks. If I know Jesus, like I think I know Jesus, it was probably a big old gala. They were having a splendid time enjoying the celebration. And that meant it was a time of rejoicing, a time to give to one another and be there to support one another. But that night, something else happened, and Jesus, knowing that he was going to be betrayed a few minutes later, decided to make a bold choice and say something about the elements that were right in front of him. You see, we're all, if we're going to live, have to eat. And Jesus took those very basic elements from the table, the bread, the wine, and said, "This is the bread of life." Oh, we got many names for it. The body of God. The bread of life, the sustaining source of strength. You see, we have many names for what this is. But it was the simplest of elements that Jesus says, when you see this, take this and remember me. He blessed it, he broke it, and said, "This is for you." He took the fruit of the vine, and he passed it to everybody. See, I like it when Jesus includes everybody. And we have equal rights for everybody. Everybody can come to God's table. And he said, "This is the cup of forgiveness. This is the cup of joy. This is the cup of setting you free. This is the cup of making us all equal in God's sight. Amen. My sisters and brothers, here at Metropolitan Community Church, we serve in open communion. That means you don't have to be a member of this church or any other church. It means you are welcome at God's table to remember God, to take these simple elements. What happens is the server will take the bread, dip it in the non-fermented grape juice, place it on your tongue, or if you so choose, cup your hands. They will place it in your hands, and you may serve yourself. All we ask is that you come with an open heart, searching your heart to say, I want to be a part of something really powerful. I want the bread of life in me. I want the cup of forgiveness in me. My sisters and brothers, the only other thing we ask is that you come as the ushers direct you, because it just makes the ushers happy. Would the acolytes and servers please come? Today is Mother's Day. You may have noticed there's some beautiful red roses up here. Hold on. Don't panic. We want to do a blessing before the final song. We're going to do a blessing of our mothers. If you are a mother and you would feel comfortable coming up, we would love for you to come up and gather around the front if you're able. I ask her to sit because I want her to be comfortable if she's comfortable sitting. Just want to make sure she's okay. She keeps telling me, I've asked her 2 or 3 times in service, she keeps saying she's okay. So as long as you're okay. All right. We just want to pray a special prayer over these, our mothers. Look, in a predominantly GLBT church, look at all of our mothers. Amen. Amen. We're going to pray a special blessing over them, and then we're going to let them take flowers and have some red roses just from our church to you. We just want to say we love you, and we're so blessed to have all of the mothers here. Would all of you in the congregation please stretch your hands toward these ladies and let's bless them. God, we thank you so much because these are our mothers. Yes. We thank you because they're the mothers of the church. We thank you because they are the beautiful creation of God. Yes. We thank you, Mother God, for giving all of these mothers to us. And we ask now that you will let them be the strong Mother God that they need to be to all of us, that they are what we need when we need it, that they can be strong and gentle at the same time, that they have all of the attributes already built in that you have, God, because you live in each one of them, and each one of them represents you to us. And God, I just pray that whatever their particular needs are, individual needs are, that you meet those needs. If their children are still with us alive and well, then I pray, God, that you will let them have some good memories today of those children. I pray, God, that all of us in this room will take a moment and remember our own mothers. And hopefully we have some good memories back there somewhere that we can hold on to. We now just pray for guidance and strength and more and more and more blessings on these your mothers, because we know a mother's love is like no other. And we just ask you to bless them in particular today on their special day. In the name of all that's holy and in the many names of God, and in the name of Jesus our Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Rise if you're able, please, and join us in our closing song.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the shine on me, shine, Jesus.
tonight. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you for this time we've had together. We thank you, Lord, for all of the mothers among us. Thank you for all of our mothers who have given us life, or we wouldn't be here today. Thank you for giving them life so that they could give us life and be co-creators with you. God, we just ask now that you will bless us throughout the rest of this day and throughout this week. Keep your hand on us. Keep us safe. Keep us covered with your power and your presence. And God, we ask that you would also bless the food that we're about to receive to the nourishments of our bodies and our bodies to your service and your divine will. In Jesus' name, amen.